St. John's is the oldest church in Sligo. We're going back to early 18th century, built, designed by a famous German architect known as Cassels or Castles. The Abbey, of course, is the oldest building in town, going back to Norman times. St. John's would be the second oldest building. And then all the other buildings in town, whether they be private or public, are nearly all, 90%, would be all 19th century structures. The modern town of Sligo dates back to Norman times. Maurice Fitzgerald and his Norman knights arrived here having conquered the rest of the province in 1235. And he appears to have stayed here for a number of years, during which time he realised that this was a very important strategic location as the gateway between Connacht and West Ulster. After the Normans left, their power began to wane in half a century or so after them arriving. So that within the century, they had gone, and while they may have left some influences around, the old Gaelic chiefs took over and came back into their own. And so that the town became the seat of the O'Connor Sligo family. And that was the seat of their power until they were dispossessed after the 1641 rebellion. During which the town was sacked and burned. The town figured very prominently in the William Knight Wars, and the Green Fort, as we know it locally, more correctly titled the Sod Fort, on the hill to the north of the town, was the centre of much attention in 1689-1690. Around that period when the William Knights and the Jacobites were warring up and down the country. And Sligo was, apart from Limerick, the last of the Western garrisons to surrender to the William Knights before the Treaty of Limerick. So that brings us down to the 1690s into the beginning of the 18th century. And from there on, the town seems to be taking its modern shape, very slowly. But it was not until the 19th century that the really was the period of growth. It's said that the town grew up around the port, and the port really was the mainstay of the development of Sligo in the 19th century. It is estimated that over 60,000 people actually sailed from here to America between 1831 and 1851. The virtue of the port trade and the fact that there was a lot of prosperous merchants in town. Some of them, in fact, that came in from outside, and quite a lot of them were Presbyterian people who came in from north of Ireland. And indeed, there was quite a number of Scotch people who came in here and started into business. So they were very enterprising people, and a lot of the thriving industries of the 19th century, particularly the late 19th century, were based on those people who had come in here some years earlier and started off, such as the Lyons's, or the Lyons's Wareshop that we have here today. It's also good to see the old buildings getting a facelift, such as the Town Hall and the Quarters, which is ongoing at present. And so there are public buildings that are rather unique. They're rather unique buildings, both the courthouse and the town hall. And now that they're refurbished, they will recapture some of their old splendour. A number of buildings have been demolished in this town in the last half century, or maybe more recently, including the Carper Campbell. But it's a pity that they have to be demolished to make way for a new road or whatever, or new buildings, that they couldn't be retained and remodeled as they have done in other towns. That was a great development along a Rockwood Parade. It gives that cosmopolitan atmosphere and look that it didn't have. And again, it's a question of could they not have been refurbished or retained, and the stone used for facing the buildings that replaced them. The one thing that strikes me is that there's very little use made of stone in the buildings that replaced them. And I think there could have been a better blend rather than the different colour schemes, which is really concrete painted over. by and large, it's a very modern town, and it's developing at a great rate at the moment, and we hope it will continue that way. And there's probably in the decades to come, it's going to be a much larger centre and more and more a centre for the development centre of the Northwest.
The school around the corner in Maugherow, County Sligo, is definitely not the same for these mature students. Over 50 years ago, they went to school through the fields, sometimes walking miles before the day's schooling began. Now they return to a very different world of learning, and this time they're ferried there in the luxury of the school bus. This is all part of a unique project funded by Sligo County Council, which brings them back to the classroom for drama, art and creative writing. For people who worked long hours most of their lives, it's a new beginning.
They didn't ever have the time, you know, to pursue an idea that might have been going on in the back of their head, that story they wanted to write or something they wanted to take up. And I found that by having three artists here and a lot of different influences coming in, people were at home in their kitchen, they had their notebooks with them, and there's a lot of different photographs and bits of writing and their very own notebook. I found that, you know, even novels were coming to mind, wanting to be written.
My job really is to make sure that they write to the best of their ability. And all I do really is just guide them and direct them as best I can, because there's very little work to be done on the writing, because not alone are these people with stories to tell, but they're also very gifted writers. And I think, if anything, this is what the process has shown to them, that not to be afraid to sit down and write, and not to be afraid to show somebody else what they've written. And it's been terrific fun. And some of the writing that has come out of it has been quite extraordinary.
I never wrote anything in my life before until I got that down on paper, and it keeps our brain active, I think, and it makes us think, you know, we won't get stagnant or rot away. But I think this now, when you have something, you go home, and even if you're not writing at home, you'll always, it'll be on your mind, and you'll be trying to think back and forward and trying to get your thoughts out, so that it'll keep you active, both body and soul, as they say.
I find it hard to get it on paper to express it right, and that it will read right or look right. I find that difficult enough.
And at break time, there's an opportunity to catch up on extracurricular activities.
It's fun, you know. You're mingling with the children and integrating with them, you know. And they, in turn, will see that we're not, you know, written off when we come to pension age.
Well, I think it's great, like, that they can come up and they can get out of their houses for a while and meet with their friends and do art and stuff like that, and write stories. Like, could bring back, like, a lot of memories to them.
They have the chance to do the art that they didn't have in school in the old times, and I think it's great for them.
The adults and children join forces for many of the activities. It's a chance to pass on skills like this rope twisting.
If you had that, if you had the fresh hay, it would be very strong. But this hay is last year, and it's gone too dry, you know.
Yeah.
You open that.
And would it withstand the gale now?
Oh, definitely. Oh, yeah. Sure, we used to put down the cocks of hay before this, and for the winter. It would stand all the winter.
All of these women spent the summer evenings of their childhood twisting hay ropes. For those were the days before plastic. Now the ropes form part of a sculpture project, which the group are working on, with the direction of sculptress Martina Coyle.
They're actually teaching the children to do it, and the children really enjoy it. So it's very interesting. They've been drawn as well, and we've been collecting various different objects, organic, inorganic material, and assembling them together. So, you know, it's great because I'm learning from them, they're learning from me, and, you know, there's a great exchange there, you know.
They get to know each other a lot better, and they get to know us and that.
And over the while that they've been coming, you've got to know them. And are they better fun than you thought?
Yeah.
Fun is high on the curriculum too.
A lot of fun. A lot of freedom, letting go, like with the ball sequence. But that's a way of warming up, and then people can have a laugh and just feel, God, I haven't, you know, let myself go like that for ages.
It's been a very innovative project. And I think it has worked extremely well, and hopefully when people from other communities come and see the final exhibit, they'll take up the idea and maybe run with it someplace else, because it is well worth doing.
President McAleese officially opened the Model Arts Nyland Centre in Sligo. The former model school, which lay derelict for years, recently won an Architectural Association of Ireland award for its refurbishment. The centre houses the County Sligo Art Collection, featuring a significant body of work by Jack B. Yeats, as well as contemporary galleries, artists' workspaces and a performance venue.
Monday morning at Markree Stables, and Major is getting ready for a very special task. He'll be just one of the horses who'll be bringing joy into the lives of some very special young riders. Major and his fellow ponies are heading for a weekly rendezvous with South County Sligo Riding for the Disabled Group. And it really isn't just any old horse who's up for the job.
The horses that we've chosen are horses that are very quiet in temperament, and they're basically suitable for the work that they've been asked to do. They're three of the most favourite of the riding school, so they're very quiet with all the kids and that, you know.
And obviously that's a consideration.
Oh, major, yeah, so that they're very settled and, you know, that they're very happy in the work that they're doing, and they're not going to be agitated or excited through any activity that's going on around them.
For the past 21 years, a dedicated and unassuming group have been inviting young people with special needs to come and enjoy horse riding. It takes a lot of willing hands to make the experience happen, but it's definitely worthwhile on a number of levels. Kate Henry is a physiotherapist. Over the years, she has seen wonderful improvements in the riders.
Remember, a lot of these children suffer a poverty of movement, which as able-bodied people we don't ever think about or really understand. They don't just move, they very often have to be moved. So that with the riding, because with the movement of the pony they're being encouraged to move anyway, they are inclined to relax, and that's one of the beauties of the horse, that he is such a therapeutic instrument, if you like. We can use him very well, and you can get the children doing things like sitting, looking straight ahead and leaning forward. Many of these children are afraid to lean forward because they're afraid of falling. And you get them sitting up straight and get them to turn around so that they rotate. Again, it's not something they do. They tend, if you watch them and study them, they tend to stay in the one position and go straight for wherever they're going. Whereas in the ordinary sense, we twist and we turn, we don't think about it. But these children really have to work hard at keeping themselves upright very often. So that movement is not that familiar to them. They have to learn it. And it's a big learning process with them.
Kate makes it all fun and games. Here they pretend to open a gate.
Now, you have to bend, right down and open the gate. Oh, it's a very low gate. Good. Okay, and down again. We put it out. Now, off you go through.
Paddy is always one of the favourite ponies.
He's got a very good stride. You might have noticed that he walks with a very long stride. This moves a lot, and that means that they get more movement in their riding, and that moves their back and gives them more exercise without them even noticing they're getting this exercise.
They're getting their exercise. You're certainly getting yours. Very repetitious.
It is, yes, yes. You've just got to realise that they're not bored doing the same thing over and over again. We might be getting bored, but they don't get bored. They have to need the repetition to learn.
You do rely on your helpers to hold on and make sure they give enough support when it's needed, and then know when to withdraw so that the child is doing as much as they can.
People are amazed, you see. This is what strikes me. They don't understand. They are inclined to say, why would disabled people want to ride? But in fact, it's very useful to them, because a lot of them are, they might have spasms, or they might, you know, that kind of thing. And when they get up on the horses, it helps them and they relax. It also helps their balance. And the fact that they are up above everybody else, it's a nice change for them to feel in a superior position. And as well as that, they are in contact with an animal, which they wouldn't normally be, and that's very pleasant for them as well.
Hey, teases you. She says you're going to be a jockey.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Would you like to be a jockey?
I do, yeah, sometimes, yeah, I do. I do, yeah.
Do you like the horses?
Yeah, I do, yeah.
And do you have a favourite?
I think there's Snowflower, one with the white on it. It's the one with the white I like the most of all. The one with the white.
Why do you like that one best?
I like horses sometimes, I like animals.
You have plans for the Olympics then, have you?
Yeah, I hope so. Just a little, I want to be in the test, all medals, I hope, double medals and be a champion in the world.
And while Jonathan sets his sights high, little Marie takes a more relaxed approach.
She's quite happy. She's not at all afraid of where she is. And she sits in beautifully. And she has been known to fall asleep, especially if we go out around the lanes for a walk. Miss Marie takes her morning nap.
There is no charge or fee to any of the youngsters enjoying themselves here, and Riding for the Disabled pays their own expenses entirely from voluntary subscriptions and fundraising events. They would welcome new helpers to the ranks and say they get as much fun and pleasure as any of the children.
Our satisfaction comes from seeing every child, no matter how handicapped, actually getting a kick out of what they do.
Sunday morning prayer service at Skreen Church of Ireland Church in West Sligo. The pews here are fuller than in many other rural churches around the country, where Church of Ireland communities have declined to a very small proportion of the local population. The congregation here, however, forms a substantial 15% of the populace, with its roots going back to the 1600s.
Well, it would have originally started off with Cromwellian settlers. Cromwellian's foot soldiers were given small holdings, which is why there would have been less landowners around here and why the population has remained.
Skreen Church history is rich. The famous mathematical physicist George Gabriel Stokes was born in the rectory, and in the graveyard stand unique carved tombs, one detailing a farmer in top hat and tails.
We don't find it elsewhere in Ireland, and it is very high quality carving. Now, looking at the clothes on the ploughman, you can see all the buttons and the buttonholes in detail, and the horses, they have the blinkers and the bridle and all the chains, they're all done to incredible detail.
Most famous of the tombs is the Black Box, erected in 1825 to a local farmer, Alexander Black, and carved by Frank Diamond, whose descendants are still stonemasons in the locality.
Actually, the Diamond started monumental work around the 1780s, and they got the stone from the seashore, which is very good limestone.
Can you give us an idea, Peter, how long would it have taken Frank to complete this tomb?
It would take him at least 3 months to carve it, and he'd have a few men, probably five or six, and it would take them at least 2 months to do the foundation and to have it erected up here.
The Black Box tomb was restored a few years ago by the Vestry Committee of the Skreen Church of Ireland, and it was in danger, and it's very good to see it having done, and great credit should be given to them.
There was a root, an old root from a tree that was disturbing the foundations, and all the foundation stones were being moved and scattered, so the box tomb was becoming loose, so decided that it'd be better just to dismantle the whole lot and rebuild from the foundations up.
The Vestry Committee, which initiated the restoration, embodies the vibrancy of this small but strong community. Fundraising is one of its primary roles.
The present church was built in 1818, and it's in dire need of restoration work, both inside and outside. Because funds are non-existent at the minute, we will have to prioritise the money as it comes in, and first priority is to waterproof it. That's new roof and pick and plaster the outside of it, and any money that's after that will be a bonus to spend on the inside of it.
The committee needs to raise £80,000 and came up first with the idea of a calendar focusing on Skreen, all aspects of which were sourced locally.
We have raised a lot of money, and we've got it out in our local shops and post offices, and it has sold very well, but there's still a few more out there. If anyone would like to buy some more, they're still in the shops, so please go along and buy one.
Roman Catholic neighbours have willingly supported sales of the calendar, an indication of the strong interaction between the two communities here.
No matter what we're doing, we always have full support. And if we run a function, let it be a dinner or let it be a dance, we get it's massive, really. It's heartwarming the way they all turn out. And sometimes if they can't go, well, then make sure they buy the tickets anyway. We have full support.
If the Catholic parish need help, we help out, and if we need help, they help out. Today, for instance, we're having an an inter-church service and walk from, starting from the Skreen Roman Catholic Church, and then we're walking up to here for Skreen, and then we'll have refreshments afterwards in the parochial hall.
That same hall is also the venue each week for the traditional Sunday school class. During school term, the children leave their parents midway through Sunday service to walk a little way up the road with their teacher, Audrey Moore, for a lesson which helps make their religion enjoyable and interesting.
Sunday school has been going on for years in this parish. They go out each Sunday just for about a half an hour from the service, and we do Bible stories and we do little drawings and pictures. They probably take more from Sunday school than they maybe would from the service, which sometimes is more adult orientated.
I like Bible stories and come and dry and cut out stuff.
Ordinary school, you have to learn all the subjects and you have to do a whole lot of work. And they are allowed to, and you get to listen to Bible stories, so you don't have to do much work.
These children are a significant key to the future of this community. Parents hope economic prosperity and greater opportunities will help them make lives in Skreen, and so ensure the continuance of their faith and strong sense of community, not just among themselves, but also with their Catholic neighbours.
And you've already vaccinated them, have you?
They're vaccinated.
Are they warm?
Yeah, the boosters are there.
Oh, so brilliant. Have you got the boosters?
Oh, the boosters are in 3 weeks' time. And
Peter,
I'll
there's the
drops.
Boosters.
And
hello.
And eye drops as well.
Marie Healy welcomes three new arrivals to her home. Three cats might make a difference to most households, but not here, for there are already over 100 cats in residence. This is Leitrim Cat Rescue, where every moggy has a name and a bed to call its own.
There were three cats who came to a house as kittens and grew up, and the people basically just don't have the time for them really now. And so they decided to surrender them over to see if we could get a proper home for them, where they'd get more love and attention, you know, because these people obviously couldn't give it to them, and they realised that, and that's the good thing, where they decided to surrender them over rather than letting them go semi-wild or not feeding them or it ending up being a cruelty case. So they're here with Marie to...
Another few.
We don't have it. Sanctuary in Sligo County, so Marie takes our cats from Sligo and deals with them. Most of the cases that we would get, they need worming, they need vaccinated, and they haven't got that. Marie takes them in, she cleans them, she worms them, vaccinates them, gives them tender love and care, all of them, regardless of where they came from and what state they came in. And you can see them, they've become much more friendly, they're cleaner, and there's a world of difference between them.
Well, when it first comes in, we try to put them in the isolation cages just so we can monitor them better. It's a smaller area. We can check if they have diarrhea, cough, sneezing, anything like that. Once they've been in a week or so, we'll try and move them out to a bigger cage, or if they've not been rehomed and they settle well enough, we tend to let them loose in the cattery. They don't do well shut in a cage. As long as they're healthy, there's no reason for them to be shut in.
All work is voluntary and there is no funding from local councils or from the state. Most of the cats are rehomed, but there are those who never get picked. These Flotsam and Jetsam live in Marie's own house. It's sanctuary for the unwanted, and they are everywhere. People must think her mad.
A lot of them probably do think I'm off the wall a bit, but the point is, when they actually meet me and talk to me, they're probably convinced. No, when they get to kind of know me and they know that I believe in neutering, and I would just love to have three or four cats here for homing if it was possible. Not all these cats. It's just there isn't anywhere else for them to go. And I mean, I would just love to see them neutered, vaccinated, and people have one or two healthy cats, and that's grand. There'd be no need for the likes of me. That's what I'd like to see. The cruelest thing you'll ever do is to let any cat out of any car in the middle of the country. They have no way of eating. A cat won't survive. It won't kill mice and live. A cat would need about 20 mice a day to survive, not one or two, if it can even catch it. They get weak, they get diseased, they die slowly.
They're more of a pet in England. They're just, cats here are generally seen as vermin, particularly in the country. And we hope that we can just make a difference and show that cats can be loving pets, you know, treated well, they're as good as anything else. We've created a dependent species, so really we're obliged to look after it now.
Local vets play a big part in the care of the rescued cats. Unfortunately, this sometimes means putting down the ones which are beyond help. But thankfully, we visited on a happier day.
Okay, then, Marie, if you go straight through, Magella will see
you. That's grand.
Can you manage?
Theo is diagnosed with cat flu and is started on a course of antibiotics. He's a strong little fellow and has a new home already lined up for him just as soon as he's on the mend. His fellow patient, Marmalade, in a fairly bedraggled state, will need lots of love and attention before new owners can be found for him. Not all the cats in Marie's care have been dumped or abandoned. Some become homeless when their elderly owners are hospitalised or, sadly, when they pass away.
In Sligo and Leitrim and Roscommon, there's an awful elderly population. But those cats are those people's pals. You won't see any pedigrees here, we just don't have any. They're just old muggies.
The Ecumenical Prayer Service was the brainchild of the chairman of County Sligo IFA, who felt it was time in Ireland to give thanks for God's protection against foot and mouth disease.
I was one day in the milking parlour and I said, you know, that do we thank God enough for, and I'm not a Jesse Jackson now, for, or a big hot gospeler. I just said, do we thank God for enough?
Some people might say, though, you might be a bit premature with this.
Well, sure. If you thank God for not getting it, perhaps you put in a little PS and say, keep at it, don't let us get it.
But those farmers in the Cooley Peninsula who were affected by the disease were also very much in the prayers of Sligo farmers tonight, and they have initiated a fund to help those worst affected in Louth.
Well, I'm very happy to be here. What we're seeing here tonight shows a huge degree of solidarity between farmers in the west of Ireland and farmers in County Louth who have suffered so badly with this foot and mouth outbreak.
It's an idea that will inspire other counties to do something similar. We want to help out those people up in the Cooleys, Cooley Mountains in particular, the people that have bred sheep into the mountains, and I understand that it takes years to breed sheep into the mountains, and whatever we come up with tonight in money terms it will not be enough.
Almost every day Eugene Ford takes a motorbike ride. Living in Easkey, County Sligo, he's never short of a beautiful place to spin around, and he's also never short of a motorbike. In fact, Eugene's problem could often be which bike to choose, because back at home he has an incredible collection of motorbikes, and they're not just any bikes. They're all lovingly restored vintage motorbikes, which he began collecting many years ago.
Almost 40 years ago now, I started collecting them, and I put them away, you know, for about up until about 30 years ago, and then I started to restore them, and I'm still restoring them ever since.
Eugene's son Jackie shares his passion for vintage bikes, and both spend every spare minute they have working on them. At the moment their project is a DOT motor truck, an old messenger motorbike, but they're having problems finding some of the parts they need.
All you need are two wheels, your axle for going across here, yeah. We'll make up the frame. No problem, make the frame and put the box on it.
Oh no.
And yeah, it's a three-wheeler.
We might come
it's
up
a motorbike wheel that goes on the back, the very same as the two front ones. That'll be no problem. We'll get one of them easy enough. It's this one portion that's causing us the bother.
The problem bike is a motorised version of this 1903 messenger bicycle, which they found in very poor condition. It was basically just a rusty frame before the Fords transformed it.
A lot of hard work went into that.
A lot of hard work is right, yeah.
Is it very rare, though?
It is, yes, it's rare enough, all right, yeah. I've only seen one other one in Ireland, anyway. So it's about two in this country that I know of 1903, anyway, of that age.
The Fords are always on the lookout for abandoned bikes, despite the difficulties and work involved in restoring them.
Very hard to get parts, and it's getting harder by the day. As I said, I had a friend that has a lathe, and he turns out a few bits and pieces if I'm stuck. And then we go to auto jumbles, and we pick up a fair bit of second-hand stuff and bring it home and do whatever has to be done with it.
And then it's down to the hard work, stripping down the bike, sandblasting and undercoating before restoring it as close as possible to its original condition.
It takes a lot of time.
You want a lot of patience.
You do, you really do now, you do. You don't want to rush anything. Sometimes now it might take you 2 years.
It must be very satisfying though, because seeing the photographs of some of them, they were in very poor condition when you got them first.
It is. It's great satisfaction when you know that a bike has been lying up for at least 30 or 40, some of them 50 years laid up, you know, maybe in a hay shed or out in a garden. And after all them years then that you hear the bike going again, it is. It's great satisfaction. There's no doubt about it.
That's how we find them. Like that. No better than that.
And they found them in some very unusual places.
One time we found a bike down in Sligo, in the back, at the back of a house. Shed had fallen down all around it. And over the years, a tree had grown up in through the frame of it. So we had to cut part of the tree away to get the bike out safely. So that was about 1923 BSA, 350cc, quite rare. That's been restored at the moment.
You're working on it?
Yes, it's going to take a long time. It's in bad condition. Well, at least we saved it anyway.
There's a fascinating history to every bike in the collection, from the oldest one to the most modern one he has, this folding bike made in 1970, a 50cc model which could be stored in a bag in the boot of your car. It never achieved any degree of popularity, though, possibly because of its price tag or the lack of the serious traffic we have now. But the bike which probably means most to Eugene dates back to World War II.
While the war was on, the factory that those bikes were being made in were bombed by the Germans. And they didn't reproduce these bikes again until the war was just over. So there are not many of them in Ireland anyway. They were known as the 3T.
The 3T was a prize-winning bike for Eugene, but every other bike in the collection has won the admiration of motorbike enthusiasts and the uninitiated alike.
You don't see this collection every day. No, you do not, no matter where you go. Yeah. Even on the Isle of Man, I go as far as saying that. I was had a man here the other day, and he said he was in the Isle of Man last year, and he was in the museum there. And he said, actually, there's a better collection of stuff here.
Bike fans regularly call in to see Eugene's collection, but there's no doubt a museum would allow many more to appreciate these vintage bikes. So far, however, the Fords have failed to generate interest in helping them further that idea. And until they do, it will just be true bikers and the Ford family themselves who will derive all the pleasure and enjoyment there is to be had from these classic gems.
16-year-old Enda Scanlon is not content to race from the comfort of his armchair. He has set his sights on higher goals, Formula One motor racing. And believe it or not, the kindergarten for this sport is the humble karting, something Enda first enjoyed at just 10 years of age.
Then as I went in, had to go to barely fit to reach the pedals first time, and had to go, great fun or whatever. And I got to get my timesheets from the organisers, and they couldn't believe it. I was about a tenth of a second outside the lap record. I was a bit nervous at first, but once I got going, I knew this is it, the speed of it. Well, I thought it was fast, and I was about 10 years old.
And it's still a great day out for the boys.
I used to watch Grand Prix races on the television with Dad. I used to look at the line they take, and that's pretty much it. Just put it into practice and run the go-karts. I imitated what like these boys used to do, worked in Senna. I used to watch, have a close eye on what sort of the direction at the corners and that. So I was never really learned or taught how to do it. It just happened naturally, really.
Enda has graduated to racing cars and enjoyed a number of runs at Mundello Park Racing School. But it's an expensive business. And although Enda is a natural, sponsorship will be needed if he is to realise his dream. For even though Formula One enjoys a huge following, unlike other sports, there's virtually no state sponsorship.
There's only about 300 racing drivers that you know that actually have driven a Formula One car, and it's very difficult. So I'm going to get a good leaving cert, hopefully get a degree in commerce and UCG or something. Well, that's what my aim is. I'll probably do that as well as my motor racing, and then I'll probably have to make a decision. Is it motor racing or is it college?
Thank you. and it's crazy lovely deal. August 1 in May, I got in the many years it, the many years it, not with the horror.
Here's our usual evening feature, Today in Ireland. From early next month, Irish men and women will have to make do on
the bombed areas in Britain. Is it self?
Shopping me stalls are laid out on the street.
Tipperary, 3 goals and 11 points. Leash, 3 points.
I hear you all.
A different type of programme.
Now, how did it all begin?
Okay, Freddy, all right.
City sights, neon lights, grey skies go blue. All kinds of everything remind me of you.
Very much and rest in peace.
I had a job to do.
The last decade has shown a huge improvement in RTE's coverage.
I really enjoy the news. I prefer to watch RTE 1 o'clock news and 6 o'clock news rather than UTV or BBC.
Good evening and welcome to 6-1.
I think News 2 is great. They've got good news coverage for kind of different areas of news that other channels wouldn't cover.
21 minutes past 8.
I can sit down and I can type on my computer and I can log into internet and I can be part of a worldwide family.
Feed the look at the Irish internet, August, and New York soil.
Any sport that wants to flourish in this country has to have RTE behind it. I remember picking up a paper and the headline was, "Let's go live." And I thought, we'll never see live GAA games on RTE. And nowadays, every weekend, we have live games beamed into our homes.
Driving into town used to be horrendous. But now you just switch on Lyric and my whole life has changed.
Are living in a happy world. Are living
in a cool. 2FM's here 24 hours a day.
Selection. Choice.
No, I think they do a very good job.
Films are good on it, they come out before BBC.
You get all the new ones first, all the premieres, like way ahead of any other channel I know.
It's my time now.
They really get all the series before any of the other stations do.
This is Mr. Soprano.
I know.
Ready or not, here we come!
I'm sure the pies are cool by now.
There's such a good mixture on RTE 1 and Network 2.
How does it feel to finally get the recognition you so richly deserve? Fantastic. Fantastic, Pat.
Why isn't this working?
Not for that telly.
Of course, it always has to get back to the bloody club, doesn't it?
Personal definition of Ireland.
Who's in the house?
The trip of a lifetime.
I think it's great that these works are being put on film, and I'm sure actually Beckett would agree and be happy too.
It's a common misconception that Beckett is a gloomy old bugger.
You personally don't believe there's any point in time.
The evidence is that you weren't providing the best margins to your customers.
George Redmond was arrested with a bag full of money.
I knew then that these allegations were false, and I had nothing to answer.
Aer Lingus cabin crews have decided to stage a second 24-hour strike.
Rog, Agam, Pichavan, Asan, Chanagi, Shaw.
Shilam. It's coma. Can cred you know what a biala target?
RTE and Ireland, forging ahead into the digital age of challenge and change with confidence and determination. In a multicultural, multi-channel environment with so much choice, RTE is committed to more than just the challenges of the marketplace. It is committed to offering a strong, dynamic and impartial service, of which we can all be proud. At the heart of our cultural and democratic life, reflecting our society in all its diversity. A unique service for a unique nation, now and in the future. Radio, television, Irish vision, RTE.